Good afternoon. We're live. We're on YouTube. We're on Facebook. And we're on Instagram. Where are you? I hope you're joining us from the comfort of your home. Maybe you're sitting down. Maybe you're at work. Who knows where you are? But welcome. I'm glad that you joined us. We're going to be doing so many fun things. We've got an echo in the studio going on, but I think that'll disappear here in a second. There we go. Cool. Lots of fun things planned for you today. We've got a full house. We've got all three platforms going. We'll be on Facebook, just like always. We're on YouTube, which we've started doing. And we're doing Instagram. This will be our third time on Instagram, which is a lot of fun. Now, hints and reminders, if you're watching it on Instagram, it's all going to be vertical. It's upright. So you can see me, and I look a little bit off center because I gave more of the table so that when I design, I'm working with that. But you can't really see all the beautiful flowers on both sides of me. If you're on Facebook or YouTube, it's going to be the horizontal. So we have a broader stage. So on Facebook and YouTube, you can see the beautiful roses, lisianthus, carnations, green trick dianthus, hypericum, and then more of the spray mums, lilies, more roses, spray roses, fall leaves. And as we work with it, I'll bring it onto camera so that you can see it on Instagram as well. Now, hints for watching. Remember, if you turn your phone sideways, the picture will be bigger. If the comments are in your way, swipe to the side. It'll make it go into silent mode so you don't see the comments and you just see the picture. The other option is to turn it vertically, and that way it puts the comments on the bottom. So you have choices. If you're watching on your computer, you can go to full screen. If you're on YouTube, you can connect it to your TV and watch it on giant screen, which I know some of you are doing that. So many different ways to see. And we've got Marisa here in the studio, and she's monitoring the YouTube, the Facebook, and the Instagram to look for your questions to be able to verbalize them to me. David's here making sure technology stays live so that we all are with you. And then we've got Caledonia and Susie, both online, greeting you, checking in, getting to know you. And then we have you. Take a moment, let us know where you're from. Get to know each other, because this is a collaboration. It's all of us together. It's not just me. It's not just David and Marisa. It's the Tulip Tribe. And I want you to get to know each other, get connected. And the easiest way is to make sure and let people know where you're from, because there may be two of you from Cleveland. There may be five of you in Michigan. There may be a whole slew of you back in New York. Who knows? Maybe you're from Romania, Iran, Afghanistan. It's always amazing to me how many different countries join us. So let people know, check in, greet each other, say hello. And then if you've got questions about being a profitable florist, be ready to ask them. Because that's what we're talking about today. The business of flowers, profitability, how to make money as a floral designer. And I'm here to share some different tips that I have found help to make it easier to be profitable. Things about buying flowers, things about designing, efficiencies. We're not going to go into a lot of pricing today. Pricing is a whole nother live stream. And you can go back on our Facebook page and look at the past lives and look at pricing. Or if you're a member of the Flower Lovers Club, you can go into the Flower Lovers Club in the Technique Library, and there are three different pricing videos showing you three different techniques used to price profitably. But today we're going to be looking more at just the overall business of flowers, how to determine how to be profitable. First, let me mention that I personally believe that profitability is better if you are a great buyer. And I don't mean hunting just for the cheapest flowers, but buying things that you know you can sell, that will last long enough to sell, and be able to stock your cooler. Now, if you're a studio, that's a little different. But if you're a storefront where you've got to have inventory, buying is a talent all its own. And I'll share with you my philosophy on price or on buying flowers so that you can be profitable is to pick a color palette first. And so today I decided to work with the autumn color palette with fire colors, oranges and yellows, a little bit of bronze, because that gave me a nice base. Then you don't want everything to be orange, so you have to adapt. So think about your color wheel and think what would be a nice accent to the oranges and the fire colors. And that's where I added in some reds, some purples, some greens, and hot pink, because I'm giving you the spectrum of the wheel so that the majority of my items are in the autumn tones, and then I've got accent colors to put with them to get a little bit of variation. Then I have four different types of flowers. I look for line, mass, form, and filler. So I start with color, and then I go to shape, and by my assortment, knowing I can mix and match so many different ways to get it to be perfect. So that's my first tip on profitability is planned buying. Now, as I get started, David, Marisa, what's going on out there?
Well, you do have some dedicated fans. You mentioned Iran, and sure enough, Carolyn responded. It's 1:30 in the morning in Iran. Facebook is banned in Iran, but she managed to break it to watch you.
Oh, wow. Carolyn, I'm honored. I'm very excited. And at 1:30 in the morning there, that's kind of late. But thanks for joining us. Hopefully we'll give you some tips on being a profitable florist that we can learn and share. Now, I talked about buying, starting with a color palette and then going to the shape of the flower. I also like to think about my containers and buying profitably there. So I just picked up, just today, these. They're just a plain plastic dish. I kind of like them. It's a nice square rather than round. It holds a half a brick of foam snugly. And then with this little square edges makes it kind of fun. We have a big event that we're doing on Friday. We have two charities that we support here at the school. I think every business needs to give back to their community. And we have two charities that we support and a third that we participate with very heavily. And the one this week on Friday is a fundraising event for the Portland Rose Festival Association. It's a nonprofit that we work with and they need 32 centerpieces. So when you're thinking about profitability, you need to think about efficiency as well as cost. So these particular vessels were perfect because I can take and do half a brick of foam, just straight out a half. I don't have to worry about carving it down. I can do one cut and then put a half a brick in. And I don't even need to tape. It goes in perfectly snug, so it's efficient. And a half a brick is less expensive than 2/3 of a brick. So even thinking along those lines, by doing half a brick, I can do two containers per brick, nothing wasted. And I don't have to do 2/3 of a brick where then I'd have all those thirds left over. So it's just an efficiency and a knowledge that I need enough foam to support the flowers, but I want to do it without having to tape it because that will save me time. And I want to have it be snug and still have a water reservoir. And there is still a water reservoir in here too. So these containers are actually pretty great. The other thing I do when I'm thinking about profitable designing is I quickly go through and score all my corners. Who knows why I score my corners? If you've had flower school, you've probably heard me talk about this, but why do I score my corners? That's the question of the moment. So Marisa, David, you watch, see if they figure out why I'm scoring them.
Don't see anything yet.
It's still quiet out there?
Still quiet out there.
Okay, I'm going to move these around so that I've got four of them on my table here. You may only see three if you're on Instagram, but just know I've lined them up and across. So efficiency and profitability can come from buying, can come from organization, can come from choosing the proper container. So, anybody got my scored corners yet? Have you answered in there?
So far, I see from YouTube, Greg Baker says, makes it easier to keep form and shape. Marmek says, insertion coverage. Amy says, scoring for easier insertion. That's what I have so far.
Those are two good ones, and they're accurate. And there's one more. When you are scoring your corners, it's easier to put a stem, there's a broken rose I had, into a flat surface. So by scoring it, I have a flat surface. So it's easier to insert that. Also, if you score your corners, it's easier to hide your mechanics because you don't have that corner sticking out. So that's where Marmek had it. So Greg, Marmek, both correct. The third reason to score your corners is when you add water, the corners just pull it right back down into the dish. Whereas if it was sticking out, it would oftentimes make it go out onto the tabletop. So it's just a little thing like that. Scoring your corners, as silly as it is, just makes it easier to design, far easier. So I've got these set up. Profitability and efficiency, designing multiple things at the same time. Never do just one. If you've got 32 centerpieces, do at least 5, 6, 10 at a time. Do all 32 laid out. But working in quantity is always faster and more efficient. If you're doing for your flower cooler, you don't want 32 of the same thing, but you can still do your base all at the same time. Pick 3 different containers, put 3 sets of foam, and then do 3 sets of greening. And then you can do different flowers, different forms, but you can still work efficiently by lining them all up like that. So David, Marisa, what else is going on?
We have people from all over the world. So from what I've been seeing so far, so from YouTube, we have Canada, Netherlands, Ireland, Arizona, Washington, Ohio, North Carolina, Italy, and Sweden. And we also have a first-timer on YouTube with us. Their name is Christian LaRoche, maybe, from Vermont.
Hi, Christian. Glad you joined us. Glad you found us. So everybody in the tribe, reach out and say hello to Christian in Vermont. It's the first time, and we want them to feel welcome. If there's any other first-timers, let us know. And if you're part of the tribe, add your tulip so that we know you're here. And let's just all get to know each other. David, what else have you got there?
Your fans want to know, where did you get those design dishes?
These design dishes were just at our local wholesale house. So it is a standard one. I don't know if it has a label on the bottom. Let's see. Oh, how cool is that? It's Diamond Line. We do a lot of work with Diamond Line. They have beautiful, just inexpensive containers. And this is a new one of theirs. So you'll be seeing this one in the classroom because Diamond Line is a great company and that's where they came from. And you can find them at your local wholesaler more than likely. It's a pretty standard company that ships all over the US. I don't know if they're international, so I can't help you with that. But yeah. This is a great container. I think it's going to be one of my favorites. Next, when you're greening, is to think, how can you get the greatest coverage with the least amount of effort? And so one of the things I do is I'll use large leaves like an aspidistra leaf and then just place it in and then grab something else, maybe some ruscus, and bring the aspidistra and just wrap it around and then spear it into place with the ruscus. So you're not taking time to find a greening pin or anything. And that whole section now is covered and concealed. Then take another leaf and maybe sneak it in underneath. And then bringing it on around. Overlapping, spearing it in place, palm, cutting it into a few bits, but not too many, because the more times you insert, the more effort it takes. maybe coming up a little bit, coming out from the side. You can actually kind of sneak it in underneath the other leaf. And again. And trying not to do too many insertions, because if you keep inserting too much, it just takes too long. Now, I did that, so I come back, repeat. Maybe I want to use a little bit of salal. Doesn't matter what you use to spear it around. Just something to hold it into place. Another leaf.
Leanne?
Yes, ma'am.
If you could just take a moment and just wave back to your Instagrammers, since you're getting a lot of waves, and I can't touch the waves, so if you want to wave back.
Hey there, Instagram people. Thanks for waving, and I can't reach over and touch it because I'm on the wrong side of the table, but know that I'm excited you're here. It's kind of fun to be on Instagram. It's a newer platform for us for the lives, and we just kind of avoided it for a while simply because of the vertical format. But I've been listening to some of our tribe, and they said the vertical format is actually kind of cool. Now, you can always watch it on both. Set your phone up on the Instagram and watch it vertically, and then turn on a tablet or a computer and watch it on YouTube, so that you can see the differences, because it is kind of fun to see how it varies. It's kind of amazing to me how each platform has its own vibe, its own way of doing it. And another. You can see I just keep adding, bring it around, spearing it in, and I don't lose sleep over making sure everything is just absolutely perfect, because you know what? It doesn't matter. No one's ever going to know. As long as you get enough in there that it holds it in place, if it looks different on one than another, that's fine. Okay. Then just coming back and adding. What I don't do, and this is another profitability technique, what I don't do is take a stem and cut it and cut it and cut it. So I have all these little tiny, tiny pieces, because if you do little tiny, tiny pieces, it takes so long just to get done, because you want to figure that every time you put a stem in something, that's money. And it's not just the money of the product, but it's the money of your time. So every time you take the moment to say, oh, I'm going to put a stem over here, that's some of your time, and it costs you money. So you want to think about that and think about how do you do it with the least amount of time invested and still have it look kind of nice. You don't want it to look funny, but you want it to look efficient. Bringing in some more salal now, because these are all have to end up looking similar. So if you put salal in one, you've got to come back and make sure you do salal in all of them. You put palm in one, make sure that there's palm in all of them. You never want to skip one. And then as I'm working, I think about balance. Make sure that I have all my mechanics concealed, that it looks good from all sides. Over here I've got a big chunk of foam showing, so I'm going to bring this in, make sure and get that covered over. Then if you remember at the very beginning, I used a little bit of the Ruscus, and then I didn't reach behind me and get any more Ruscus. So I'm going back now with some Ruscus and adding that in. If you take classes with me, you know I like to have three or more foliages in every arrangement. And I really feel like it makes it look so much more interesting, and it doesn't lose money because you're not doing more foliage, you're just doing varieties of foliage. And when you have a variety, all of a sudden the whole design looks more exciting, more interesting. The customer goes, oh wow, look at that, how fun is that? You get different greens, different leaf format, all kinds of movement. So you can see how they're all coming together now. See a little piece right there. So it's coming together. Ooh, dropping my coffee. We can't have that. We don't want to lose coffee. So those of you that have been in flower school, you know three types of foliage. Now that you've been on profitable designing, you know shop wisely, think about colors, work in groupings. Then the other thing that I do when I'm working on something like this, I always bring in just a little vessel, a little container like this one, so that when I have maybe a little piece left over, I do stick that one in there so that it doesn't get wasted. So I always have one little container that's just available to be using up all my leftover broken things, because there's always those bits. And so this one ends up being almost clear profit, because it's things that might have ended up in the garbage because they weren't big enough for something else. And I might come back with a little bit that I actually did cut down to fit, to fill it in. But for the most part, this particular container would always be just my leftover broken bits to fill in and make sure that I use up all of my materials.
Leanne?
Yes.
I just want to do a shout out to a few more new viewers that we have on off of Facebook that I've seen. We have Susan in Star, Idaho, and then I believe it's pronounced Maria in Miami, and we also have Lori, and then Kathy is a first-time live viewer, however, is seeing all your YouTube videos.
Hi, Kathy. Hello, everyone. It's fun to have first-timers join us because you bring a new perspective to things. You look at it differently. Don't hesitate. Ask questions. Now, as I'm working here, we're thinking profitability. We talked about buying. Pick a color palette. Then enhance it with colors that will contrast. Think about your flower forms. Something linear. Something mass. Something form. Something filler. Then as you design, choose a container that holds the foam snugly so you don't have the extra technique of taping. Saves you cost on the tape. And time. Then as you're designing, work with a variety of different foliages so that it creates interest and contrast instantly, using bigger insertions so that it doesn't take you as long, making sure that everything looks great before you even begin. Then, once you have it all started, go back and start flowering. Now, as I'm working on this, what questions do you have for me? You may be wondering more profitability things. What are you thinking? What makes you go, I wish I knew? Because right now, I'm yours for 1 hour to ask your questions, get them answered. Let me know what you want to know. And we'll just keep designing and working and designing and working. Now, these are going to be fun. The end design, it's going to have red roses because it's the Portland Rose Festival, so that's their thing. It's got to have the red roses. And then I have martini glasses that are going to tuck down into every one of them. They'll each have two or three martini glasses, and then those will have a big skewer with olives on it tucked in, so it looks like a martini with an olive. It's going to be so fun. It's going to be just grand. I can't wait to get these done. We'll make sure and post pictures of the finished ones so that you can see. Of course, we keep them low because they don't want them to block the viewing. It's an auction, so people will be raising their paddles, bidding on different things. So everything has to be kept low enough that it doesn't interfere with the auction and that people can see who's bidding for what. So we'll always do them very, very low. Sometimes a tall centerpiece is grand because it gives you so much more drama. But when you're working with an auction, the drama is wonderful, but if they can't see who's bidding, not acceptable. So gotta keep it low. And I'm just bringing things in, bringing some all the way down low to break the line, some up a little higher to bring it through the center. leaving a hole here where I'm going to tuck in the martini glasses, not champagne glasses, because I don't want those to be missing. Those are going to go right in here. Then adding some depth by tucking some a little lower, pulling them in tight. But notice how I'm making sure that every single one has its own space, that it's not crowding anything else so that it will show. Because if they're paying for the roses, they want to see the roses. You can see how it all comes together. And then room in the center for the martini glasses. Then I scooch it over, come back to the next one, start adding more. And by doing them all at the same time like this, it's fast and it's easy. Now I have a question for you, okay? David, Marisa, you're gonna have to watch because I want them to answer, but we're gonna do it in a tricky way. I don't want you to answer with a number, okay? Because this is personal, this is about you, but you just put in there done or a dollar sign. That's what we'll do. We'll each put a dollar sign. Just put a dollar sign so that we know you came up with a number. But I want you to think, if you believed that you were a profitable florist, and if you believed that you were paid what you were worth, how much do you want to make per hour? Okay, don't tell me the number. I don't want to know, because everybody's number is going to be different, because we all are in different situations and different circumstances, different overheads, different expenses. But how much do you want to make per hour? Put that in your mind. You might even write it down on a piece of paper. Think about that. And as soon as you have a number in your head as to what you want to make per hour, add a dollar sign in the comment field. Just put that dollar sign in there. David and Marisa, you tell me when we've got some dollar signs so that we know that people have their number figured out. Because then I want to talk to you about making sure you earn what you're worth. Because if you can't earn what you're worth and make a living, you're not going to stay as florist very long. So don't put your number in there. Just put the dollar sign. And let us know that you've thought about what your number is, how much you need to make to feel like you're successful and profitable as a floral designer. This is kind of a fun exercise that I make myself do periodically, because it's an eye-opener when all of a sudden you stop and think about it. So you get your number and then I'll help you kind of go through the process and see what we come up with.
Well, you've got a lot of dollar signs coming.
Yeah.
Good. So you guys are doing it. Good job. Because I want to know what you think.
Are you wanting them just to put, not a dollar amount?
Okay. Just the dollar sign, not a dollar amount. Because I don't want to know what your dollar is. Because that's a personal thing. Everybody's going to have a different one. Some of you might be happy at $10 an hour. Some of you might want $50 an hour. Some of you may need $37.50. Some of you may want $150. I don't know what your number is, but I want you to know a number and think about that, because then we'll talk about that from a profitability standpoint as a florist, what it takes to make sure that you get paid your number. And I'm almost done. Marisa, while they're finishing getting their dollar signs in there, would you grab a couple of those martini glasses that are out on the table? That way I can show them what they look like, because it's kind of fun. Almost done here. Isn't that grand? You know, the one thing about doing centerpieces in the red and green like this, it's a complementary color harmony. So it really makes the roses stand out. It shows them well. And everything will look more festive. Red is always a good color to use for party work. And so it makes me happy that the Rose Festival always chooses red. Now the martini glasses are plastic because we didn't want to invest hundreds of dollars in martini glasses that people are not going to keep more than likely. But you can get plastic ones. They're great. And they were very inexpensive, like maybe 50 cents a piece, something like that. I don't know. I don't remember what I paid for them, but they were very inexpensive. And just being able to tuck those in here, that's going to be so cool. And the easiest is just to use a taped wire, wrap it around, anchor it in place. And just anchor that down in there, tucking it. And then I can bring another one in. And I could get a third one. And then we're going to put a little bit of glitter on the inside. And then skewer the olives and set them in, just as if you were at the restaurant getting a martini. And I think people are going to really like these. Now, I don't have them all wired in place, but you can see, once this has glitter in it, how it's gonna sparkle. And then adding the green olives on the skewer pick, that's going to be so much fun. Everybody's going to have a ball with these. So that's pretty great. Now I'm going to move these out of the way because now we wanna talk about your earnings. And I'll show you another arrangement, do some other things. I just wanted to share with you profitable designing, working in quantity. David, what you got there?
You got one very good question here that you can answer while you're working. How do you get over the feeling that you're charging too much?
That's a great question. How do you know that you're not charging too much? How do you have the confidence to charge what you're worth? Because as artists, we question ourselves. And oftentimes we go, oh, can I really charge that? That's so expensive. I don't know if I can charge that or not. Very, very fair question. So let's go back to what do you want to earn? And I'm going to just pick some random numbers. I don't know what your number is, and I don't want you to tell me your number. But how would you know what you wanted to charge? How do you figure it out? How do you decide what you're worth? One thing that I find valuable is to think about what other industries are charging. What do people make in other things? Think outside of the floral world. What if you were a plumber? You might charge $125 an hour. What if you were a handyman? You might charge $30 an hour. What if you were an attorney, a lawyer? You might be charging $250 an hour. What if you're an accountant? Might be $200 an hour. They charge these numbers because they've invested in their education and their training. So they need to be compensated for that because they spent time in school studying, learning to be a lawyer. How many years does it take to be a lawyer? It's a lot of time in school. Maybe they went to an automotive repair school and now they have a skill of repairing vehicles and they need to be paid for that time. Maybe you went to flower school. You invested in yourself. You invested in your career, and now you need to be compensated for that. So one of the things you think about when you're figuring out your pricing is what do others charge, and then how does that compare to you? What did you invest in yourself? You know, if you invested 3 years studying, and maybe $10,000, you want to be able to get your investment back. You want to be able to say, okay, I justified this expense because I did this. One of the things I do after I determine how much money I think I need to make, when I think about how other people charge, I start thinking about my time. So if you want to make $50 an hour, okay, let's pick $50 as a starting point. If you want to make $50 an hour, how many arrangements can you make in an hour? Okay. And if you're making a $50 arrangement and it takes you an hour, you can't make $50 an hour because you still had to buy the flowers, you still had to do the flower processing. So if you can do a $50 arrangement in 10 minutes, now you might be able to get to $50 an hour. But do you have enough business to do five $50 arrangements in an hour? But if you start thinking about how long it takes you to make something, it helps you determine how much you need to charge so that you can get paid. So if you said you wanted $50 an hour, and you know that it's going to take you an hour to do this, and that might be a combination of going and getting the flowers, processing them, making it, putting it in a box, and sending it out on delivery, then you need to sell that arrangement for $150, $200 minimum to be able to pay yourself. That doesn't even start covering your overhead. But just thinking about how fast it's going to be to get done, how long it's going to take you, what do you need to accomplish to sell this particular arrangement and be able to make what you want to make. Kind of thinking about it from that standpoint of how long does it take? What skill does it take? You know, did you study flower school for 3 years to make sure that you knew how to do it? Did you get the fully certified floral design certificate so that it proves that you truly have the knowledge? And if that's the case, you should be compensated for that knowledge. Because education has value. And that's the difference between a professional and a hobbyist. Hobbyists can have a great time and do beautiful things, but maybe the flowers don't always last as long because they just don't know. Maybe they don't know how to price it. Maybe they don't know what's the best way to keep it alive for as long as possible. Whereas a professional has studied, they know which flowers will last well. They know which flowers mix together well. They know that they shouldn't mix the daffodils with something else. They know that the hydrangeas will do better if you have alum. They know that dahlias will do best if you boil them. They know that every design has to have a color harmony. That's the professional side. You can see I've got my greens all in here now, and it's starting to look good. One of the things I find, again, is the multiples. I'm going to get myself a drink here. I'm starting to cough. I design in multiples because I'm more efficient, I'm faster. Then if a customer wants to spend $100, I have a larger arrangement. If they want to spend $15, if they want to spend $10, but what I'm getting here is maybe I have 100, 125, 135, 145, maybe I have $150 worth of flowers here that I'm doing all at once. Because I can get them all done in about the same amount of time that it takes to do one big one, because you're just kind of working with things. Maybe it's going to be $250 worth of flowers. You can just know. Now, if you were with us last week when we did the Halloween with Teacher Shell, two things came up. We were using materials that we didn't know how they would last. One of them was coleus. So if you were with us last week, you may remember the coleus. This is the exact coleus that was in the red vase that she made at the end of the live. It's been sitting out at room temperature. Look at that. It's still beautiful. It's gorgeous. So now, you as a professional know that coleus, if it has ample water source, holds well. And I knocked into that, sorry about that. Then, you may remember I had some cut fuchsia. Yes, the fuchsia, like you see out in your garden. I had some cut, I took that home because I didn't know how it would hold. And I wanted to see how well it would hold. I didn't have any to bring in to show you because it all died. It didn't hold. It lasted about 3 days, that's all. Now it was beautiful, I enjoyed it, but it was only for 3 days. So fuchsia is something that you would use just for a party, an event where it just needed to last for the moment. It certainly wouldn't be something you'd send out to your weekly client because they would call and complain because it died so quickly, and you don't want that to happen. You want it to last a little longer. So again, that professional knowledge. Now, if you're thinking about flower school, we have a promotion coming up because we want to invest in you so that you can invest in yourself. Because it's really important to take the steps to be profitable. And in our classes, we teach you the pricing, we teach you the buying, we teach you the care and handling, we teach you the professional techniques that you need to be a profitable florist and to market yourself so that you can make a living. Because I don't want you to be out there being a starving artist. You deserve more than that. You deserve to be successful. You deserve to make whatever that number is that you were thinking about. You deserve to be able to be paid that. But in order to do that, you have to invest in yourself, get the training, get the professional skills, and go with it. So, the deal. We have a couple of things. One, if you're just wanting to check it out and see what it's all about, think about the Flower Lovers Club. Because we do have 3 pricing videos in there. We have lots of care and handling information in there. We have techniques in there. So it has some. Somebody was asking about a casket spray video. And yes, there is a casket spray video in the Flower Lovers Club. So that's in there for you. And with the Flower Lovers Club, it's only $59.95 for an entire year. So it's a huge value. Huge, huge value. And I know many of you are already members. And I want to thank you. Because it's because of you that we can do free education. It all works together. Marisa, what you got?
Marmack's calling you out. Your Betsy on the front is falling out in the front of that arrangement.
Oh, it is. Good. Look at that. Oh, my gosh. Good
catch. I wish you could see that.
Good catch. So let's get that back in there a little better. Now, see, if I hadn't been to flower school and met Marmack, I wouldn't have known that was falling out, and somebody else would have just said, oh my gosh, look at that, it's falling apart, she can't even do it. So thank you. That's what we need, is to have everybody have the back. Now, if you haven't gone to flower school, that's the other promotion we've got going on right now. And it's only for 10 people, because I set a code up, and I'll leave it on until 10 go in. Because we needed to keep a limit on it so that the teachers can keep up with you. We don't want to overdo it here. So 10 people can use the code LOVEFLOWERS. David, can you put that up on the screen? Okay, thank you. So if you use that code LOVEFLOWERS, it will give you $200 off on basic or advanced floral design. Limited to 10 people, and you can only use it once per person, so you can't use it twice, once for basic and once for advanced. You only get to use it once because I want 10 different people, but I set the code up so that it's once per user and then it will stop at 10 people to get $200 off basic floral design so that you can get started doing what you love and learn more about being profitable. Now you can see I'm bringing in the orange and hot pink. And I remember when I said I started with the fall palette with the oranges and yellows, but then I wanted to bring in some accent colors. So by bringing in the hot pink with it, it gives it such a cool look. It really makes it just shout out and sing. Then adding in the flowers so that I can do it at different price points.
So Leanne, quick question, because you were talking about this. We had someone earlier ask, when you're doing like the rose arrangements that you were doing, do you put the same amount of materials in each one?
That's an excellent question. When you're doing event work, you do want to have a recipe that says, you know, everybody's going to get 11 roses, or everybody's going to get 10 roses, everybody's going to get blah, 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 blah. I start with a recipe, but then I give myself a little wiggle room, because you know how it is when sometimes you put it together and there's a hole and you just need one more rose. And other times you put it together and it's full already. You don't need anything else in there. So I set a recipe, but then I let it go back and forth a little bit. So some will have a little bit less, some will have a little bit more, but they all are going to be, let's say the recipe is 10 roses, then I would say 9, 10, or 11 is all fine. And that's the way I do it. Other people are absolute that they must exactly have 10 in every single one. I'm not quite that strict. I like to have a little bit more variation. And sometimes it just turns out that you need one more flower. You know, you've all been there. You just need one more flower. But don't buy more flowers than they've paid for. So if you use one more flower in every single one, you're going to run out of flowers. So you can't do that. So you got to be a little careful. What else you got there?
Okay, so FH10 on Facebook, you're going to like this one. Okay, so someone had told her, or they, I don't know if it's a, yeah. So they said, someone told them that you should green up for traditional designs, but then put your flowers in first for modern designs. Is that true?
You know, that's a great question, and I totally disagree. And I also totally agree. How funny is that? I say, do whichever makes you feel happy. You can green first, you can flower first. I tend to do whatever happens to be at my design table at the moment. So if I have all my greens there and I'm ready, I'll go through and green everything. If I don't have any greens at my table but I have flowers, I'll go in and stick the flowers. And then once I know what else I need, then I go get my greens and put them in there. So it can be either or. I can see why they would tell you that, though, because if you green first, it's going to be a fuller, a mass of foliage, whereas if you flower first, you're going to have a little more negative space, so that could be a real positive, especially in a contemporary design, getting enough negative space in there. So if that makes it easier for you to keep negative space, then do that. If you prefer to flower first, go for it. If you prefer to green first, go for it. It really doesn't matter. It can be either or. But you know, if one is better for you, then you would say, this is the way I do it. And I always do it this way, because you can. You get to choose. You get to choose how you design. You get to decide how much money you're going to make. You get to decide what you're going to do. The key is to think about it. Think about that number that you thought about it before. Let's go back to that. If everybody had their number, how many arrangements do you need to sell to make that number? Now, if you have a good markup, you won't have to sell very many because you're making profit on each one. If you have a really low markup, then you're going to have to sell more and work more to be able to get to that, and you might not be able to get to your number. And then you get unhappy and you think, oh, this is too hard, and you give up and it just doesn't work. So you've got to be really conscious of that. Okay? So you can see how I've just got everything in here now. Let me put another one in here. It's all quick and easy. And if you are thinking about flower school, use the Love Flowers code. Save yourself $200. Join us. And get a career started that makes you happy. Because Floral design is a happy career. It's something that you can do for the rest of your life, and it's something you can do profitably, but you have to plan for it. You have to plan to make profits. You have to plan to price appropriately. You have to plan to buy appropriately. What do you think? Do you like these? If you do, tap your screen, send us some love. If you're thinking about flower school, get registered. If you know somebody else who should join us for flower school, tag them. Let them know that 10 people get to save $200. Make sure that you spread the word. If you haven't shared the video yet, you might go ahead and do a share so that it goes out there. And then, oh, I've got to use some of these fall leaves. They're just so beautiful. Look at that. The color on those is spectacular. It is the season. It is the season. It's just, everything's in such vibrant color here in the city. I'm excited for our students that are joining us for the class on October 21st. We do have 2 spots left in that class, so if you're thinking about using your code, you can use it for October 21st. There's 2 spots left, and you can come and join us in the classroom. Works for online too. You don't have to come to Portland, but those that are coming to Portland for the October 21st session, the added bonus is we'll be with Lansu Chinese Garden doing the 9th Moon Floral Design Showcase, which is going to be amazing. We've got floral competitors coming in doing an exhibition of floral art in the Chinese Garden, and the class will all get to go. We've got tickets for everybody so that you can go and be part of it, so you can see what's going on. It just makes for a pretty fun time. Plus, if you want to be part of the exhibition, you can volunteer and be doing floral jewelry, helping out with the demonstrations. We've got centerpieces to make. We've got so many things that we get to do. It's going to be so much fun. This is the season of all of the different things. Okay, Marisa, what else have you got there?
Amy wants to know how you learn online. Like, how does that all actually work?
You know, Amy, if you look at our Facebook Live from 2 weeks ago, I actually did a full demonstration that showed how the student portfolio worked. But in a nutshell, when you study from home, everything is done with video streaming on any device, so you don't have to be worrying about DVDs and all that stuff like we used to do 100 years ago. But now everything just streams, so you can watch it on your phone, you can watch it on your tablet, on your computer, whichever way. Then once you've watched the video and done your reading, which the reading's all online too, so it makes it super convenient, then you gather materials in your own town, create the designs following the assignment lesson plan, then take a photograph, send that in to your teacher, and then you'll get a written evaluation critique, really giving you hints for improvement. Now, many of the people on the live today have been in our online classes. So if you've been in the online, or if you've been in the classroom, let them know what you thought. Let them know how it worked for you, because it is an excellent way to learn. It's so nice that now in this day and age, you can learn online, you can learn in person, you can learn whatever way works best for you. So the online classes are easy. So if you can join us that way, it just makes it fun, fast, easy to study from home. You've got the convenience of not having to travel. You've got the convenience of having those lessons available to you forever. They're not going to go anywhere, so that you can keep watching, learning, thinking. Now, I'm just about done with these, but I want to make sure that I've answered everybody's questions. So does anybody have anything else out there that I need to be answering?
Well, I'll give you a comment. It's been fun for me to watch some of the seasoned members of the Tulip Tribe with their comments on efficiency. And Ricky shared one, never make one arrangement at a time. He learned a long time ago, always make one arrangement to fill the order and an identical arrangement to put in the cooler.
That is so true. If you're in a flower shop and you've got an order to fill, make the one that you're filling for the customer, and then make a second one to put into the flower cooler, because it takes you virtually the same amount of time to do two arrangements as it does to do one arrangement. So why not turn it into a profitable venture by working efficiently? Now, I just thought this would be kind of fun. Let's say you had a customer who wanted something a little bigger, but they didn't want this big, but you didn't need to make another one. You can just go back and tie two together so that this arrangement becomes one arrangement just by knotting it all together. I'm going to take that one back out. Just do the two. And you can see how it just gives it a little bit of flair. And then if you wanted to just add something to this guy to make him a little more fun, just doing a knot and sliding it in. See how it gives that movement? Marisa?
Okay, this might be a big question for going towards the end of the live stream, but I'm kind of going to put two together. So Stacy has been told, to be precautious when switching careers because many florists are afraid of the future profits since technology is online everything. And then also Risa wants to know how to educate the customers to appreciate the floral business.
You know, those are great questions. And educating the customer is oftentimes just making sure they see it. And for us, that's one of the reasons we do the Lansu Chinese Garden, because we take fresh flowers out to the garden, sharing them with the public. And the more you let public see it, the more they know that you can do it, the more they'll appreciate it and consider buying it. So oftentimes, just taking the time to show things a little different, letting people see how creative you can be. In my flower shop, we always made sure we had one really special arrangement that was unique and different that gave us the opportunity to really show off to people. And we would just put that in the cooler and say special today. And it would be an arrangement that would be maybe a little different than what we would normally sell. But it educated the consumer that we were capable of doing something different. And then it let them be brave and go, oh, that's kind of cool. I like that. So we've got just a minute or two left. So any questions before we say goodbye? David? Marisa?
I have one from YouTube from Olivia. You may want to go over maybe 30 seconds on the live for this one. But I wanted to actually reach out for her because she's asking, for those that have taken online classes, if they receive the same type of instruction quality that they would in the classroom. So I'm hoping that maybe some people can answer that for her.
And David?
So you're going to time out on Instagram very shortly. So say goodbye to your Instagram fans so when they time out, they know that you really do love them.
So Instagram people, it does automatically turn off at 60 minutes. So if it cuts off, know I love ya. And get out there and do something you love, but I'll leave you live until that very last minute. But if it turns out at 60 minutes, that's what's happening. Then the question is, does online give you the same benefit as in the classroom? And we have done this for so many years, and I've been able to work with so many students that I can tell you, yes, you do get the benefit online that you would in the classroom. It's quite amazing to me. We have so many people who will do their basic studies online, and then come join us in the classroom for their advanced studies. Annalise is here right now. And so she just finished her online basic and now she's in the classroom doing her advanced. That way we can see what skills were put together from online, and the students from the online and in the classroom are equal. And you do still have that one-on-one time with your teacher. You have myself, you have Marisa, you have Carolyn, you have Michelle, you have Shell. So you still get lots of input, lots of love, lots of support. And we're there online with you. We're there on the telephone with you. You can pick up the telephone and call. You can send us a picture and say, I need some help with this. And that's what we're here for, because that's what we do. We support our tribe. And every week on the live, you've got your whole tribe together in the collaboration that you can reach out to them. So if you're part of our online studies, you could reinforce to her, let her know how it worked for you, let her know that it was fabulous. And then if you're one of the 10 people, use the Love Flowers code, that'll work for 10, and we'll get you started so you can be certified, start making money, being profitable, and doing something you love. So I'm going to have to say goodbye because our time is up. We'll see you next week. Teacher Maurice is going to be on camera with me. We're going back to one more Halloween stage. So if you want some more Halloween information, it was so much fun last week. This week we'll do Halloween again with Teacher Maurice. So we'll see you at 3:00 Wednesday. But for now, thanks for joining me. Thanks for being part of my tribe. Really, really, really appreciate you giving up an hour of your life to collaborate together. So I'll see you next week. Get out there and do something you love.